And today we're going to be discussing something which is very topical, the Arogya Setu app, which has been in the headlines recently. Today, we have three lawyers, Gautam Bhatia, Surit Parthasarathy, and Rinda Bhandari with us. All three of them are experienced digital rights litigators, and we hope to draw upon their learnings and their knowledge of previous cases like the Aadhaar challenge to see and understand what kind of a trajectory Arogya Setu could take in the upcoming months. Before we begin the discussion, I'd like to give you a brief background about Arogya Setu so everyone's on the same page. As most of you may know, Arogya Setu was first launched by the central government in early April of 2020. While the app's stated purpose is contact tracing, it has also been integrated with the e-pass functionality, and it also contains a self-assessment tool which provides a person a COVID risk score based on personal data that the person feeds into the app. While the government had initially reassured the public that the app would be a purely voluntary measure, it has been made mandatory for wide sections of society. Most recently, the Ministry of Home Affairs, through guidelines issued on 1st of May under the Disaster Management Act, has made Arogya Setu mandatory for all persons living in containment zones and all employees belonging to the private and the public sector. Any violation of these guidelines and failure to download Arogya Setu could lead to criminal prosecution under provisions of the Disaster Management Act. So with that said, I think we can now move on to substantive concerns about Arogya Setu. The app has been criticized on many grounds, but one of the most preliminary objections regarding the app has been the fact that despite collecting sensitive health and movement data of millions of Indians, it is not governed by any legislative framework. So Gautam, maybe we'll start with you. Could you tell us whether this is a valid criticism and why is it so important for something like Arogya Setu to be anchored in primary legislation?
Thanks. So a couple of things. One is that it's the law. So the law require. I mean, the Supreme Court's on multiple times, multiple occasions held that if you are infringing a right, be it privacy or any other right, it might be justified or it might not be justified. But the basic minimum that you have to do is to pass a law that sets out the circumstances under which you are infringing upon that right. And the reason for that is a very straightforward one. It is that we live in a parliamentary democracy where parliament is the body that is the elected body of the people. Parliament deliberates on legal issues and then enacts laws which the executive implements. But the decision on what law to enact, what the shape and form of that law must be, is a decision that must be taken in a deliberative forum, in a forum where the debates happen between the representatives, and then you pass the law. And this is also why you have checks and balances. So for example, Rajya Sabha, right? The upper house needs to also pass those bills. And often, as in the case of Aadhaar, for example, the upper house actually sent back a number of important amendments that were bypassed because it was a money bill, but that's a different issue. But the basic idea is that if you bypass parliament and both houses of parliament, then you're losing out on a vital check in a democracy, which is important for protecting rights. It's not just the court, it's also parliament. So that's, I think one crucial issue. And the second is that what you're seeing here is that you have these two laws, the Disaster Management Act and the Epidemic Diseases Act. These are two laws that are ostensibly enacted to deal with disasters or epidemics at the central and the state level. And what you have seen is that all these measures, including Arogya Setu, are being sourced back to very, very broad clauses in these laws that are effectively enabling clauses. They enable the executive, the government, to take whatever measures that the government deems fit to tackle the situation. And if you look at that long term, that's quite dangerous, because that is effectively permanently removing parliament as a checking body from the equation. So once you invoke a clause of the NDMA or the Epidemic Act, then effectively it becomes a pure rule by the executive government. So they are living under a rule by decree. It's no longer a rule of law, a rule by, you know, by elected bodies. It's simply the executive whose task is to actually implement laws that then becomes the single body that both makes the laws and implements them. And as we all know, one of the fundamental features of democracy is that you disperse power, you distribute it, you don't have it in one authority or one figure. So that's also a reason why you need a framework of laws under which all this happens, and not just a decree imposed by the government as it sees fit. Have we lost Devdatta?
I think we lost Devdatta, but I guess we could just continue. So I think like there's two more reasons, apart from everything you've said, why laws are really important. And one, the actual act of drafting a law means that you end up, you know, describing the procedures of collection, storage, use in detail. You end up laying out safeguards in detail. And actually laying that out in a law enables certain safeguards to be built in. It is much easier to have an executive decree that says Arogya Setu will be mandatory, but the executive decree doesn't envisage, you know, the exceptions that would have to be built into the decree. It doesn't account for the fact, for instance, that 25% of Indians, only 25% of Indians own smartphones. And so how do you deal with everyone else? It doesn't really specifically prescribe, you know, the collection practices beyond what is there in the terms of service. So I think the act of actually having a law makes a huge difference. And we see this in Aadhaar as well. The Aadhaar Act, as well as the regulations that came, were very detailed. And they did, you know, prescribe different, you know, powers and responsibilities and checks and balances that were built in. It also enables a successful, like, legal challenge eventually. So I think that's one very important reason to have a law. And I think, Gautam, you've already referred to this before in your writing. And the other reason is, this is not something that we're only seeing unique in India. There is this assumption, or there is this belief, that in times of emergencies, maybe judges and, you know, the judiciary needs to step back and give more leeway to the government. But in fact, it is the opposite. In times of emergency is when, and this is an emergency which has not been, you know, notified as an emergency under the Constitution. So in times of a public health crisis, it is more important for courts to, you know, stand in its, use their powers of judicial review to actually check the actions of the government. In the UK itself, the Joint Committee, the Joint Parliamentary Committee on Human Rights, came out with a report, and they said that apart from the fact that the UK already has a data protection law, they need to enact a specific law separately, because that is also important from the purpose of trust. It's only if citizens believe that there is a law, they will have trust in the government, and that will actually result in increased uptake. Of course, in the UK, unlike India, the app is not mandatory. So that's another reason, I think, why having a law would help. Sudhit, if you also want to...
I don't have too much to add to this on the need for a law, but I can only say that it's been sort of one of the most inviolable principles, almost beginning right from the first big constitutional case, which was A.K. Gopalan versus State of Madras, that to restrict a fundamental right, that to restrict the right to personal liberty, the first thing that we need is a procedure established by law. And that's clear even from the text of the Constitution itself. And that law has to be a law that is made by a valid legislature. Now, of course, from A.K. Gopalan, we've come a long way in terms of moving from the existence of procedure established by law to a more substantive due process check. But this principle that we need in underlying legislation before fundamental rights can be restricted has been clear from the text of the Constitution. And it's been evident, I think, from really A.K. Gopalan onwards. Now, of course, as both of you pointed out, there are many parallels here with the Aadhaar program. To begin with, Aadhaar as well, much like Arogya Setu, was rolled out without legislative sanction. It was through a set of executive notifications that the UIDAI was instituted. And it was tasked with this job of identifying people using biometric information and then providing people a unique identity number. And they went about this job of enrolling millions into the program without there being an underlying law for that purpose. And ultimately, when they realized that they needed to enact a legislation, they made the Aadhaar Act, and they had to ensure through Section 59 of that Act that all of these prior actions that they had carried forward were in fact validated. And I think we've seen sort of the enormous public mischief that was generated by the fact that a program of this kind, sort of a breathtaking bureaucratic exercise really, was put in place without there being an underlying law. Now, of course, I think there are a lot of takeaways as well, as Brinda mentioned, from the fact that the Aadhaar Act itself had a number of substantive checks and balances that were built into the in terms of what the executive could do in executing the program. But even from the judgment, I mean, many people might consider the petitions as having failed, apart from the striking down of Section 57 of the Act. But even apart from that, there was a watering down of a number of other provisions. So there are a number of takeaways from that judgment, which we can discuss, I think, in the context of Arogya Setu. I mean, I can point out at least, I think, three takeaways, right? Three important takeaways. One, of course, flowing from both the first Puttaswamy judgment and the second Puttaswamy judgment, is that there exists today a fundamental right to privacy. The Constitution recognizes it. And second, as we've discussed so far, that this right can only be restricted by law and by subscribing to principles of legality, necessity, and proportionality. And third, and this is, I think, important, is that the majority's verdict in the Aadhaar case actually makes it rather manifest that the creation of a surveillance state would be unconstitutional. The judgment, for example, holds that the state should not be in a position to profile a person through the information it collects. And to that extent, it read down a number of portions of the Act. And it also sort of imposed a set of restrictions on the basis of, on the extent of data collection. It employed principles of data minimization, and through that it also struck down Section 57. So I think there are important takeaways from that judgment. And I'll just make this one final point in terms of why we need a law. Because if we didn't need a law, we could simply have Parliament making one broad law to suggest that here, you know, power is hereby granted to the executive to do whatever it wants to in public interest in order to put in place any program it deems fit, not merely to tackle the COVID-19 pandemic, but to do anything in public interest. So then we're sort of left languishing without the rule of law, really.
And also, just to add to that, I mean, part of the reason, you know, you actually have laws and not just this broad standing laws is because the act of having, you know, passing a law means you have legislators coming together and actually bringing up concerns that may be very particular to a certain constituency, a certain class of people. You know, things, especially in a country like India, which one executive decree will never be able to take into account. So there is, even the deliberative process of democracy is really important.
Thank you for those insights, Gautam, Surat and Brinda. I missed out part of it due to technical glitches, but the parts that I heard made a lot of sense. Moving on to another issue, something that has also been very widely talked about is concerns of function creep and exclusion. While Arogya Setu is currently being promoted as a contact tracing app, there are fears that it may soon become a precondition for accessing various goods, services, and essential facilities. This will obviously have an exclusionary impact in a country like India, where large segments of the population do not have access to smartphones or the internet. How far do you think these concerns are likely to determine the constitutionality or validity of something like Arogya Setu? And what can we do to prevent this kind of a function creep? I'll start with Brinda this time, and then maybe Surat and Gautam could also pitch in.
So I think the concern of a function creep is a very real one, and parts of that are because of, you know, what we are seeing in the terms of service, or rather what we are not seeing. So, you know, there is no proper sunset clause that's been built in. We also heard the IND minister saying this may be, you know, used for the next couple of years. There is a fact that the purpose limitation, as the IFF working paper itself has demonstrated, isn't really present in the app itself. There is no clear prohibition about the use of the data, the sensitive data that is being collected, whether that will be shared by other, you know, within agencies of the government. So is there going to be intra-government sharing? Which I think is the biggest concern, you know, which raises concerns about function creep, surveillance. It is that if you are saying Arogya Setu is important as a measure to tackle COVID, there is absolutely no reason why that data and why your location data should be used for other concerns. And one of the things I'd like to point out, although this is not directly related to Arogya Setu, this comes up when we talk about, you know, COVID and surveillance. The Broadcast Engineering Corporation of India Limited, BESIL, released a tender, and it was for a patient, a COVID-19 patient tracking tool. So it was meant, you know, to call for tenders to develop this COVID-19 patient tracking tool. And one of the first operational points of the tender specifically talked about law enforcement. It said it is for investigation purposes. It is to look at suspects. It is to allow, and I mean, I'm not quoting, but it's somewhat along these lines, to know where you work during the day and where you sleep at night. So these concerns of function creep, I think, are very real, and we are seeing them coming under the, you know, the guise of COVID-19. When it comes to exclusion, I think at this stage, there is a distinction between Aadhaar and Arogya Setu, because Aadhaar was a based on the various notifications that were passed and eventually Section 7, Aadhaar was a precondition for accessing benefits from the state. At this stage, it's not exactly clear whether Aarogya Setu will become mandatory. So you've talked about it being integrated within the e-pass system. So I think there are two separate concerns. One is if it is going to become mandatory for accessing various services or being able to cross the border or being able to enter your office. Or is it going to be that there are going to be two tracks and one which will be faster? So we saw this in Aadhaar as well, that you can get a SIM card faster if you give your Aadhaar number. So one, if you're going to have a faster track, which is Aarogya Setu enabled, and one, if you have a regular non-Aarogya Setu enabled track. So I think those are the issues of exclusion that we would have to deal with at a future stage, but may not arise as much currently.
Yeah, can I mean, yes, I just want to add to that. I mean, the issue of function creep, as Vrinda mentions, is, I think, in many ways linked with exclusion, as in rather the idea of when exclusion might occur is in many ways directly linked to how this function creep takes place. I think, to my knowledge, India appears to be the only democratic nation that is compelling the use of a contact tracing application, even in certain limited forms, whether within containment zones or of government employees, etc. And a lot of this, again, is linked to the first question that we discussed, in the sense of there being no underlying legislation. And we also, unlike many other countries, we don't have a data protection law. So, you know, the makers of the Aarogya Setu app appear to be suggesting that they followed the draft data protection law. But I don't see how this can fill us with any real sense of confidence, because it doesn't even appear to give the appearance, to borrow sort of George Orwell's words, of solidity to pure wind. And, you know, ultimately, I think unless we have a legislation which clearly lays out a framework of how this app is going to be used, I don't think we can, you know, really sort of even test its effectiveness, test its utility, test its necessity. And there's the other issue of illegally collected evidence, right? I mean, in India, we have this sort of some sort of a pervading confusion over how illegally collected evidence is used. And this in many ways is linked to the idea of a surveillance state. Now, of course, there's a recent Bombay High Court judgment, which Gautam has discussed on his blog, of how the court sort of struck down the use of illegally collected evidence and said that such evidence won't be admissible. Even though over the course of time, the general jurisprudence by and large has been that the law makes admissible evidence which in fact is illegally obtained. So if there is evidence that's obtained through Aarogya Setu, even if it completely lacks the backing of legislation, and even if it is completely unconstitutional, would such evidence be admissible? Now, unless we have, I think, jurisprudential clarity on this, we can only see the app as sort of laying an even greater framework for a surveillance state.
Gautam, would you like to add to that?
Yeah, I think there's two more points. I think one is on function creep. I think this is the old adage, you fool me once, shame on you, fool me twice, shame on me, which really applies here, because what we saw with Aadhaar was a classic case of function creep that extended over many years. It begins with multiple guarantees and assurances that it's a voluntary tool that will only be used to streamline the delivery of welfare benefits to those who need it the most. That voluntary step by step, scheme by scheme becomes mandatory, and then you extend it to income tax, and then you extend it to bank accounts, then you extend it to mobile phones. And each time your justifications become more and more stretched, it goes from welfare leakages in welfare delivery, but there at least exists some initial foundation in fact, to the limited extent that there are leakages. I mean, of course, Aadhaar is not the solution to those leakages, as a long debate on that part. There's at least some kind of basic foundation in fact. From there, you go on to all kinds of magical arguments about hawala transactions and shell accounts in banks and terrorists using SIMs, which gradually become to come untethered from reality. And if you look at how that process is over like 6 or 7 years, you see that it's basically it's the whole boiling a frog slowly by raising the temperature. Whereas you know that if you start off by having this multi-purpose app that effectively is a surveillance app, there will be a certain kind of pushback to it. So you begin by saying that, okay, this is only meant to tackle this public health crisis, and you need to use contact and tracing to deal with that. And then as and when the pandemic, you know, begins to decline, you expand its use. And you can see already there was a recent Twitter thread about, you know, what should we use Arogya Setu for once the pandemic is over, which is telling in its own right. And if you see the comments underneath that, they include comments that people who were involved in the creation of Aadhaar, and you see stuff like building a health stack, medical insurance, so all kinds of purposes that have nothing to do with contact tracing and tackling the pandemic. Which brings me to my second point, which is that, and this goes back to the issue of requiring a law that clearly delimits the scope of the use of this app, and you can't therefore just have this constantly evolving set of users that, you know, you don't know what it will be used for tomorrow. Secondly, that to make it clear that this is an app to be used to tackle a temporary public health crisis. It's not a general purpose app that, you know, can then be retrofitted to deal with a more permanent situation, whether it be law and order, you know, or health more generally. Because if you want to do that, then there's a whole different debate to be had at that point about what you need to address, say, a law and order issue or like an enduring health issue. And the last thing on that is that this, I think, takes us to the importance of the fact that you cannot delineate issues of design and the issues of law. A friend of mine often says that law can't fix what code has broken. So there needs to be a discussion, and this goes to the point of the calls for making the source code open and things like that, that if by the design of the app, you are creating something that can later be used to enable more far-reaching uses, then that has to be questioned at this point. And why have you opted for that design and not some other more limited design? And this includes, you know, sunset provisions and all of that. So I think that these three points are what I would add to this discussion.
And just to add to something both Surit and Gautam said, you know, Surit made the point about surveillance. And I think it's very important when you look at it in the context of other laws. If you see the Census Act, the Act actually specifically states that the information that will be used will be confidential, will not be shared by any other person, because the census obviously also collects a lot of sensitive information. And it says that the information collected will not be admissible in civil or criminal proceedings. So it is very important to have that carve out, which is there in the Census Act. Even the Prisoner's Identification Act says if a prisoner is discharged or acquitted, all the information collected will be destroyed. So it is not that laws in India that collect personal information do not have a provision for destruction afterwards. And on the point that Gautam made about, you know, a sunset clause and, you know, when would this, you know, the nature of a crisis, I think it's very important to think about right now it's being justified for COVID-19. Will the government then say, look, let's keep this data because who knows, a COVID-20 may occur. There are talks that the virus will again reactivate next year potentially or till the vaccine comes. So for how long will this crisis and this emergency period last? We've seen the UP government pass an ordinance where, you know, reportedly they've said that most labor laws will not apply for 3 years. So what is the nature of this crisis is also something that I think is very important and obviously goes back to the idea of having a law and having a definite endpoint to this data collection.
Thank you to all three of you for highlighting how surveillance structures that we are putting in place now to respond to a pandemic will probably survive and be repurposed even after COVID-19 is over. And thank you, Gautam, for bringing up the issue of technical design choices, because that sort of takes me to my next question. We know that Arogya Setu has already been challenged before the Karnataka High Court, and any litigation around, Kerala, and any litigation surrounding Arogya Setu is likely to require the judiciary to evaluate the technical design choices which have been made by the app's developers. And this includes things like, you know, for instance, not limiting itself to Bluetooth and also collecting location data, following and using a static device identifier for anonymization instead of a dynamic device identifier, etc. So as people who've been engaged in, you know, tech litigation before courts, to what extent do you think we can expect the judiciary to understand and appreciate what impact choices have on making Arogya Setu a tool of mass surveillance in future and the right to privacy generally?
Should I start or?
Yes, Gautam, please do.
I mean, this is something that I've been thinking about for a long time. And it's also something I struck me a lot. I was peripherally involved in the litigation challenging Kenyan version of Aadhaar, which took place in a very different way than the Aadhaar challenge took place. And I'll just explain that. So, I mean, the starting point is that when you have a legal proceeding, there are many disputed questions of fact. Is something true or is something false? It's a very basic factual question. And to address that question and to arrive at an answer, the law has certain processes that we broadly understand as the law of evidence. And central to that is that both versions that are in contest have to be brought to the court and tested against each other. So if I am claiming something and I say I have developed an app, right? And I claim that this app is the least intrusive method of achieving the goal of tackling the pandemic. So ideally, I will be brought to court and the other side's lawyers can then question me. And then they will have their own, experts who will controvert what I'm saying, and then my lawyers can question them. And through these competing versions, that puts the court in a position to adjudicate between them and decide what set of facts are, more persuasive. And this is actually what happened in Kenya. So in Kenya, during the challenge, they basically, the petitioners had technical experts who took the stand and were questioned for like two days about, the differences between centralized and decentralized databases, federated databases, all of that. And then the state's technical experts who had designed their biometric ID were also asked to take the stand and questioned by the petitioner's lawyers. And there was the bulk of the proceeding over the course of a week was basically this cross-examination. Now, in India, it's a little different because for various reasons that are too complicated, I think, to go into right now, the proceedings start at the High Court or the Supreme Court, which are effectively appellate courts. And so there's a broad distinction between facts and law. And so in the appellate courts, the facts are meant to already have been settled, and then you argue on the law. So apart from extraordinary situations, you don't normally have evidence and cross-examination taking place in these proceedings. What you do have is affidavits being filed, and then lawyers arguing on the basis of those affidavits. But you don't really have the people themselves who have developed the app or developed Aadhaar being questioned in court, and that happening. So that already, I think, really detracts from the level and the awareness that you can kind of create in a courtroom in these technical issues. And I think that the only way of combating that within the constraints that we have in the Indian system is to, as happened in Aadhaar, to file very detailed affidavits by technical experts that lay out in detail the link between the technical design that has been chosen and the impact it has on fundamental rights, civil rights, right? So to basically draw that link very clearly, that look, there were these two or three possible design choices. Say, for example, in the Aadhaar case, a centralized database on the one hand versus smart cards on the other, where the biometrics are stored on the card itself. So you say that you had these two design choices. Both these design choices are equally effective in addressing the issue of welfare leakage. One design choice, the centralized choice, enables surveillance and other forms of rights violations in a manner that the other one does not. And therefore, in choosing the more intrusive option over the less intrusive one, the state has breached its obligation under the Constitution. So that is the structure of the argument that has to be made in a case where you have issues of technical design that are at the heart of what the dispute is. You present the alternatives and show to the court that there exists an alternative that can accomplish that goal without infringing upon rights to that same degree or that extent. And once you do that, you do two things. One is you establish the link between the design of the system and the issue of the Constitution, law, and rights. And the second is that then the government has to explain that, look, why didn't you as the government choose less restrictive system. If in the UK, in Singapore, other countries, the contact tracing apps take less personal information, why have you, the government, when you had these options available to you existing in actuality, picked a more intrusive one? And once the government is required to explain, you often find that the explanations aren't really there because they don't exist. And so I think these are some of the ways in which these things can happen in court. But I think the really important thing, I think this is still very much an issue of legal culture, is that there's still an assumption that tech and law operate in silos. And therefore, the court is there to decide the questions of law, but the court doesn't have the competence to look into questions of tech. That, of course, is dangerous because it is the tech choices that determine what rights are violated or not violated. And so I think what you need is a broader alliance between lawyers and technologists, which happened in the Aadhaar case, and this kind of like constant awareness being spread among lawyers, legal culture, and also in the tech domain, that the issues of tech and civil rights and constitutional rights are deeply interlinked, and one affects the other, and that goes both ways.
Can I just add to Gautam's?
Yes, sir. Please add to what you already said.
This, I think, is sort of a complex issue, and I think it's a big project in many ways, and I think it might well be the defining project of our times, because it's linked, I think, to every other form of freedom, to the values that our constitution espouses in many ways. And I think if we don't give this problem the attention it deserves, we might well be placing our democracy in peril. And I'm not talking here only in terms of judicial review, but also in terms of how parliament has to function in making laws where technological solutions are proposed. Now, we already have sort of the idea of pre-legislative scrutiny, right? Having parliamentary committees, and we need to get these committees functional on things like this. We already have specific committees for information technology law, but we need to fill these committees with lawyers, ethicists, apart from coders and technologists. And we need to have scrutiny at that level before the law itself is made. And certainly at the realm of judicial review, I think we need a paradigm shift. I mean, we need it more generally, but we certainly need it in terms of how courts view cases such as this, where technology is so deeply involved. There's an interesting speech that was delivered by Lord Sales of the UK Supreme Court, where he suggested an independent body to examine the court, sort of an algorithm commission, if you will, which will be independent of the courts, which will be independent of the parliament and other governmental bodies, where a challenge is made before a court claiming that a particular application or a particular technological solution is unconstitutional or it violates one statute or another. Then you have this algorithm commission sit and deliberate, take evidence both from the claimants and from the respondents, and thereafter submit a report to the court. Because I think there's a sort of an inherent problem when you mount challenges of this kind, where courts tend to view this, as Gautam pointed out, this sort of technology and the law existing in separate silos, and courts somehow tending to believe that they're not equipped to answer questions such as this. And I'm not suggesting for one moment here that we have tribunalization, because I think that would be altogether more dangerous. We need courts to be armed with the resources to deal with issues such as this, in order to deliberate and decide challenges to technological solutions in a concrete and cogent manner. But I think courts need all the help that they can, you know, get from the outside in deciding this. And which is why the other point that Gautam made is important in the sense of petitioners shouldn't be rushing to the courts in the first instance with very flimsy or little evidence. I mean, you need to mount and build a case together, and that case needs to be built. I mean, even if it's going to be submitted through affidavit, it needs to be cogent and it needs to be well-structured and well-researched, and you need to sort of arm yourself, use the Right to Information Act where it's necessary, use other devices where it's necessary, and build a case before you go to court. But, you know, it's also important because our entire legal doctrine in deciding cases such as this is fact-based. Because as much as we try to look at constitutional courts as appellate courts and as somehow, you know, being outside the factual realm, if you look at the broad doctrine that is used to test violations of fundamental rights, such as the right to personal liberty or right to privacy, it's this doctrine of proportionality, which is a fact-intensive scrutiny, right? You have a test of necessity, you have a test of utility, and you have a test of whether the measure employed is the least intrusive measure. And the only way you're going to be able to decide this is by factual deliberation and through appreciation of evidence. So therefore, it's all the more necessary that courts build a structure where they can, you know, if cross-examination is the way to go, then so be it. But you need to build this. You need to build this culture of an evidence-inducive method of judicial review. And there's an interesting post on Gautam's blog today where I think which discusses sort of three different cases and how the courts have gone about this proportionality review. And in terms of who the burden will lie on, because and what the post suggests is that when the petitioners come to court, they do have a certain burden to at least present to the court other measures that are potentially available. It's thereafter for the state to establish, based on a review of those materials, that it chose the least intrusive measure. So there is a burden on both parties in many senses, and it's ultimately a question of how the court appreciates this evidence before coming to a final conclusion.
I could also just add a couple of points, or maybe give an example from the Aadhaar litigation or the recent Kashmir litigation. So, you know, when we come to the point of how the government is going to discharge burden, and in both in the Aadhaar litigation as well as in the recent Kashmir litigation, where we were seeking a restoration of 4G internet for the people of Jammu and Kashmir, the petitioners had filed affidavits of experts. So in Aadhaar, it was a security expert who talked about the surveillance structure. It was people who went on the ground and exclusion that was happening as a matter of fact. In Kashmir, we got a technical expert to explain the difference between 2G and 4G, because the whole petition was premised on the fact that 2G, you know, the restriction of internet speeds to 2G is disproportionate and unconstitutional, and hence we should go back to the status quo of 4G. It was very important to explain the technical difference of 2G versus 4G. And I think we as lawyers need to recognize our own limitations in terms of, you know, some of these technical issues. So it is very important for us to collaborate with the experts to present that evidence. But having then discharged this burden, what often happens as a matter of practice is that the state, while responding in its counter affidavit, doesn't actually deal with the affidavit at all. So there is no real denial of the affidavit. There is almost just a ignorance of the affidavit. And you kind of sort of just continue the arguments that, look, 4G, the denial of 4G in Kashmir is not actually causing any exclusion. It's not causing any difficulties. And this affidavit, so apart from the technical affidavit, we had also gotten, affidavits where people were talking about their experiences of living in 2G. So explaining the problems, you know, the very real life problems that were caused. So, you know, or not being able to teach geography, for instance, except, you know, you needing internet for that, needing video conferencing for that, because how do you explain the structure of the globe? You know, examples like that. So the government doesn't then really respond to the affidavits, but it sort of just denies the claim in and of itself. And so then you're left with the point that Surit is making, which is, how does the government then discharge its burden of proof? How does the government say, beyond, you know, in Aadhaar, the language is mere ritualistic incantation of black money is not enough to justify Aadhaar linkage of bank accounts. Mere just citation of national security, public health, that in itself is not enough. The government actually has to discharge its burden. So this, I think, is a problem, that we are trying to file affidavits, but there is no real response from the government not being asked this. In Aadhaar, what happened was slightly different and quite sui generis, I think, which is where the actual regulator, the CEO of the UIDAI, Ajay Bhushan Pandey, was called to court. And, you know, he was not cross-examined, so we were not allowed to cross-examine him, but we could give a list of questions. And there was no sort of follow-up questions that were really permitted. So we gave a list of questions, they gave a list of written answers, and, you know, those you can see in the judgment themselves. But there was no real questioning. So it's also interesting, if the state is allowed to call, you know, someone who can explain the design, but the petitioners then are not allowed to call someone. So I think these are real issues which one needs to think about when you're thinking about litigation, you know, using proportionality, and, you know, it's a fact-intensive litigation. So I think we do need to think about these challenges as well.
Thanks for that, Prinda. So we have so far been talking about how contact tracing apps like Arogya Setu can be deployed in a constitutional and rights-respecting manner. But I think a more preliminary question is whether these apps are effective at all and what are their rates of inaccuracy. For instance, there's a lot of evidence out there which suggests that because smartphone signals and Bluetooth signals are not a good enough proxy for virus exposure, you may end up seeing a very large number of false positives and false negatives. And in this case, if someone does get a false positive, the consequences could be quite severe. You could be quarantined. could lose your income for that period and your freedom of movement. So do you think that courts are likely to go into the question of what are suitable means for the government to deploy to sort of, you know, calm this public health crisis? Or do you think they're more likely to defer to the government's judgment about what is necessary and what is not, and then insist on certain safeguards being followed? We saw something similar in the Kerala High Court's sprinkler decision, where the court said that if the government says that they need sprinkler services, we're not going to question that judgment. But what we will do is we will put down all these safeguards to make sure that the data cannot be commercially exploited or misused. So what do you think is the correct balance here? Anyone would like to go first? Surit, maybe you?
The idea of efficacy, obviously, it's a very important consideration. And we've already seen a number of reports on how contact tracing applications aren't especially efficacious, that they lack utility. There's the paper by the Brookings Institute, for example, and which is why there is a real fear that this entire exercise will turn into a Trojan horse of sorts, where it becomes a surveillance device ultimately. And I mean, again, we keep going back to the Aadhaar judgment because that is the one big example that we have, right, in terms of how the Supreme Court has responded to challenges of this kind. And if you look at the judgment, what you'll find is that the court simply doesn't engage with this third limb of the proportionality test, because alternatives were suggested by the petitioners. For example, there was the PDS system in Tamil Nadu, which was suggested as a potential alternative. There were smart cards and social audits, which were used in Chhattisgarh, which were suggested as alternatives. But the court simply dismisses all of this in one paragraph, where it says that there were no alternatives suggested, which I'm afraid was simply contrary to the actual facts on the ground. So are courts best placed to decide cases such as this? I mean, I would think that courts ought to decide cases such as this, because the efficacy test is an important element of the proportionality analysis. But will courts do it? That's the other question, and that's the harder one to answer, which is why this sort of links back to what all of us were mentioning in response to the previous question, which is that when you go to court, you need to go to court having amassed as much evidence as possible, and go to court trying to present every other conceivable alternative that you think is available and show the court that this might not be the least intrusive alternative available at all. And it's only when you present that evidence can you get the court to try and really come to your rescue, because if you're not going to go with that evidence, then the court is certainly going to buy the version of the government, because the broad principle that is applied generally in constitutional jurisprudence is a presumption of constitutionality. Right? That is that when the government makes a law, that law is presumed to be constitutional. So the general burden lies on the petitioner to establish that at least prima facie, there is something wrong with this law. And then the onus will shift to the government. Now, of course, there's a larger debate to be had in terms of when this presumption should apply and when it shouldn't apply. But in almost all of these cases, the presumption would apply. And it's therefore up to the petitioners to be in a position to present to the court concrete evidence to show that there are other alternatives, and thereafter try and convince the court that this particular alternative that the court is, that the government has chosen, is not in fact efficacious. This links back to the previous answer. Presently, I don't think courts, the way the system of judicial review works, in terms of just purely exchange of affidavits, etc., it's not the best model to decide on efficacy. You need courts to engage with the evidence with far greater rigor in order to really come to a factual conclusion on whether something is efficacious or not. But these are jurisprudential facts. Jurisdictional facts. I don't think that the court can shy away from deciding these disputed questions. It's the court's responsibility to decide these questions, because they go to the very sort of root of whether a particular law is constitutional or not.
Brinda Gautam, would you like to add to that?
Do you want to go first, Brinda?
I think like Surit has covered most of it, so I don't really want to add much, except just sort of give these examples that, you know, you talk about the problems of false positives and false negatives that would come out with using the app, which I think become very important when you're thinking about the design structure of the app. So apart from the fact, is Bluetooth, for instance, will it always work? Or will it also capture, you know, information between walls? So if I'm in one room and someone is in another room or another house, and if there's just a wall separating us, will that track us as being in the same region? If I'm on the balcony and someone is walking on the road, will the app account for the fact that we are in different places, or will it sort of give a result that we have been in close proximity and hence we're at risk for infection? So these are obviously, you know, some of the concerns that have come out. There is a Twitter story that's there. I don't think it's been reported by news outlets. So, you know, obviously we have to take it on its word. But three roommates, you know, posted a screenshot saying they're all roommates, but their Arogya statuses were all different. And how is that working? So I think, and you know, the Brookings paper does a really good job of laying out the false positives and the false negatives and the problems with that. Apart from the fact of, you know, stigmatization, which is another issue that they raise, that people will just not want to actually volunteer the correct information about themselves. And I think stigmatization we've already seen in India is a real issue with actual consequences. So I think these are just some of the additional things to, you know, ponder about when we look at the suitability of the app in this case.
I have a slightly less legal response to this question. So that, and this again draws from some of the learnings of the Aadhaar case, which is that many of these issues around suitability and you know, whether it works or doesn't work, things like that, it's very easy for courts to ignore these issues if they're not convinced that the violation of rights is of a serious degree or nature. So a threshold issue we faced in the Aadhaar litigation was to actually convince the court, and I guess even convince the broader public, that there is something wrong here that needs attention. Because you keep getting this very common, intuitively commonsensical answer that you go to the airport and you know, you give your biometrics to the American embassy and Google knows all this about you. So what's your problem with giving your fingerprints to the state, right? Now, I mean, there's a long answer to that, a long response to that, but the intuitive power of that objection is such that it becomes easy to dismiss the concerns as being just, you know, fringe or niche concerns that aren't really central, you know, in any or important in any way, and therefore let the government experiment, give the government play in the joints, give them the space to make mistakes and get things wrong, because there's nobody's been really harmed by it. And so then, you know, you have all these arguments that, okay, it might not be perfect, but we're getting somewhere. And so, you know, why do you want to interfere? And that again brings me back to the whole point about people who are well-versed with tech and lawyers working together, because often the harm that an app like this can cause is difficult to crystallize or to just conceptualize in simple terms. In a way that can be persuasive. In the Aadhaar case, it took many months and I think many years for the lawyers to even understand many of the issues. They're hard to grasp for people who don't have ready access to the vocabulary of tech. And so I think that any discussion around something like Arogya Setu, like Aadhaar, has to begin with an acknowledgement of the very real kinds of harms that techno-utopianism or tech solutionism can cause, the specific kinds of harms that this solution can enable or cause, and then from there to point out that, look, given that there are all this possibility for harm, you can't impose or you can't mandate something of this kind without first making sure that it actually works and is least intrusive. It's a bit like the whole clinical trials issue, right? I mean, it could be easy to say, look, we have a pandemic going on, so like, skip the clinical trial part of the vaccine and just like release it into the market, right? We obviously don't do that because we understand that when life is at stake, or you know, when health is at stake, you can't skip the clinical trial stage of vaccine development. You have to go through that, even if it may take more time. So similarly, I mean, we have to find a way of conveying the point that, like in the case of vaccines and clinical trials and drugs, you can't skip the stage in tech development or tech solutionism where you actually carefully look at if it works, what the other alternatives are you minimizing infringements of rights and so on. So we need to, like, I think really find a way to communicate the importance and say, like, this whole like vocabulary that someone like Nilekani and others go with, right, that move fast, break things, like, it has to be like, we have to have a way to point out that, look, that's completely wrongheaded. It's not about move fast and break things. It's actually about, like, move as carefully as you can and break as little as is possible to break.
Thanks for that, Gautam. And yes, it is super important for us to convey to the public concepts like, which may be amorphous like privacy, but they have a very real and tangible impact on their everyday daily lives. We've so far talked quite extensively about separation of powers and how the parliament, executive, and the judiciary are all expected to keep a check on each other. But there's another important constitutional principle of federalism, which I don't think we've addressed so far. Even though public health is a state subject, you see the Arogya Setu app being conceptualized and rolled out entirely by the central government, and then subsequently being made mandatory by an arm of the central government, which is the Ministry of Home Affairs. Do you think this in some way undermines the ability of state governments to adopt solutions which are suited to their local context and to sort of even question the deployment of such apps way in the privacy of their residents? Surit, Gautam, any of you, if you would like to answer?
Yeah. I mean, this is a harder question to answer in some senses because public health is a state subject, but you also have an entry in the concurrent list, which is list 3, which talks about prevention of extension from one state to another of infectious or contagious diseases. So which means that both parliament and the state legislatures have the broad power to legislate on those subjects. But of course, we have a situation here where you don't have a legislation at all. And this goes back to our fundamental point. Parliament hasn't actually legislated on this in terms of providing for an application that would help prevent the extension from one state to another of COVID-19 or of any other infectious disease. So in general, I think there's a larger concern where we've seen a withering of federalism over a period of time. And there's this broad belief that India is somehow has a federally organized constitution with a strong unitary bias. And we've seen this sort of repeated as an adage almost, constantly. But if you look at the constitution itself, there are clearly delineated powers and limitations, right, in terms of where the center can legislate, where the states can legislate, and again in the concurrent list in terms of where both the center and the state can legislate. Now, of course, where a matter falls within the concurrent list, and where both the central and the state governments can legislate, and where both have in fact legislated, a state legislation would be repugnant and would require the assent of the president before it can be effective and before it can be executed in the state, which would then effectively mean that the union cabinet would have to give clearance to a state legislation which is made in the concurrent list, which is otherwise repugnant to a union parliament enacted legislation. But here we have applications that have been rolled out by some states. I think Telangana has its own application, which it's certainly entitled to make because it has the power to do so under either by invoking its powers under list 2, since public health is a state subject, or by invoking its powers under list 3. But in the absence of a law, it's also bewildering that we are somehow, okay with all of this. I can't quite fathom how we can be comfortable with the idea that a technological exercise of this kind would be carried out without legislative sanction. This goes to the very foundation of the rule of law. This goes to the very foundation of a constitutional democracy. And in the absence of a legislation, almost everything that we are discussing today is all sort of dependent upon the existence of such a legislation. Unless we have such a legislation, we are effectively arguing about what might happen should such a legislation provide for various limitations. So in general, I think states should be given as much play in the joints as possible. They should be given as much freedom to come up with their own. And you have this famous term of states acting as laboratories of democracy, right? So I think states should be allowed to act as laboratories of democracy to the extent possible. And we've already seen how Kerala, in implementing many of its policies, has, in many ways sort of quelled the spread of the pandemic to a certain extent. So states have been setting examples for other states. And we, in an ideal scenario, we want as much decentralization of power as possible. And I think when we speak about decentralization, we don't want to speak about decentralization only from the center to the states, but also from the states to panchayats and panchayati raj. And that's also an important point to make, because I think you ultimately want power to vest in the people. And the only way in which power can vest in the people is by decentralizing decentralizing power as much as possible, and you want to give as much stake as possible to Panchayat Raj governances in order to for them to have a say in terms of how governance should be carried out, even in terms of how technological solutions should be implemented. Because, you know, if you were to have a real deliberative democracy, and Vrinda was making this point earlier in terms of how legislatures act as deliberative bodies, you know, it's only by deliberating with these other bodies, even with people at the level of these local governments, that you really sort of understand how a technological solution has to be framed. And we've had an application here that's been made by a set of people without, I think, any of these deliberations. And that's where the real problem comes.
Vrinda, Gautam, would you like to add to that about federalism? Or we can also move on to the audience questions, because there are quite a few of them in the chat box. So the first question I'm just going to direct towards Vrinda, because as a Noida resident, I think she will have the best opinion on this. So as you will see in the chat box, we have Arvind asking us, what is the legal standing of cities or states, like in the case of Noida, making it mandatory and filing FIRs or fines if the app is not installed?
Yeah, I think this is obviously an issue that's close to my heart, because I also live in Noida. But apart from obviously all the arguments we've already made about not having a law and, you know, all of this sort of questioning the very constitutionality of the app, what happened in Noida was that it is an order that has been passed under Section 144 of the CRPC, which makes it mandatory to have the Arogya Setu app. Otherwise, you can be penalized and, you know, proceedings under Section 188 CRPC can be initiated against you. So in addition to all the arguments that we've made, I think it's also important to look at the invocation of Section 144 itself. So the language of Section 144 actually, if I can just, yeah, it talks about the power of the district magistrate to issue an order just let me find the exact terminology, to direct any person to abstain from a certain act. So the language of Section 144 is very clearly to direct any person to abstain from an act. Whereas what the 144 order that has been passed is actually making, requiring a person to do a mandatory positive act. And a lot of cases in India from the 1930s, the Calcutta High Court in a bunch of decisions, which was then followed by various high courts in 1970. So there was the Gujarat High Court and the Patna High Court have held that Section 144 is only permissible to be used to actually restrain someone from doing an act. It cannot allow the government or the district magistrate to require me to do an act. So for instance, in one of these cases, the direction was that the petitioner could not leave Midnapur district for 2 months. And the court said that you cannot direct him, you can direct him to not leave, but you can't actually ask him to move to another place. Or if you've been asked to fill in a certain excavation, one of the judgments talked about filling in a certain excavation. They said you cannot actually ask a person to fill in the excavation proactively. So I think apart from the arguments that we have already raised, Section 144 cannot direct me to install the Aadhaar Act and then face criminal sanction under Section 188, because such orders have been held to be ultra vires the terms of Section 144. In fact, in IFF itself has held draft representation under Section 144.5 of the CRPC to the district magistrate, asking for, placing these facts on record and asking for a reconsideration of the order. And sort of, we're still awaiting the DM's response on that. So I think in addition, Section 144 introduces new challenges.
Thanks for that clarification, Vrinda. There are two more questions being asked by the audience members which relate to terms of service of the app. The first question is about the fact that the terms of service contain an exemption clause which exempts the government from any liability for misidentification of a person's COVID status. And the second question also talks about how the terms of service and the privacy policy do indicate that the data will be retained for different time periods in different types of cases. What do you think, Surit and Gautam, if I may ask you this, what do you think is the value or validity of these kinds of clauses which appear in privacy policies and terms of service? And can they be used to sort of undermine fundamental rights in any way?
Uh, I think in general, in terms of, I mean, the original idea in sort of jurisprudence of contract law would be that there is a consensus ad idem, right? In the sense that two parties come together and enter into a contract where they're sort of without being influenced by coercion or undue influence or misrepresentation or mistakes of fact and so on and so forth, and that they enter into an agreement for a valid consideration. This is sort of the basis of contract law. Now, in the case of digital contracts, I think you have to recognize, and courts in different jurisdictions have recognized, that there is a balance of power at play. And apart from there being this sort of case of most people, I mean, you essentially saying, I agree, right? And because there's this question of, and this goes back to the point that Vrinda was making earlier, in terms of how these applications are often seen as necessary in order to be eligible for various different services. And when it becomes necessary, and when there's a function creep of that sort, then it means that you're not really looking into these terms and conditions. You're sort of almost virtually forced into accepting. And here is a case where the government has virtually compelled people to download the application. So when coercion acts in this form, I don't think a contract of this kind can really be considered as an enforceable contract in the eyes of the law. You'll have to sort of read down some of these terms and make them susceptible to various fundamental rights, including the right to privacy. And I think there's also a larger public policy issue here. And we all know that contracts which are, you know, sort of opposed to public policy stand vitiated. And when you have a program which is inherently unconstitutional, that I think would be the very definition of and when you allow for contracts to be executed for such a program, I think that would sort of be the very definition of a contract that is vitiated by public policy.
I'll just add one thing, which is that the issue with making the privacy policy the basis of determining the validity of the app is that those policies are set unilaterally by the developers of the app, endorsed by the government when it makes that app, you know, mandatory. And what has been set unilaterally can at any moment be altered unilaterally, right? So you need a more enduring form of binding the government to its obligations, which can only happen through law, which is why a privacy policy cannot substitute for the legal framework that sets limits on what can be done and what can't be done using that app.
I think we've lost Devdatta.
That's okay, Vrinda. Would you like to add on to this?
Just one point. I mean, I think both Gautam and Surat have made fantastic points. So just to add to that, also, what is your grievance redressal mechanism? I mean, so the privacy policy will say, oh, if there's any grievance, write to the grievance officer. The reason you have a law is you have an actual grievance redressal mechanism in place. You know, you can file a proper complaint. You can go to a data protection regulator, for instance, under the data protection law. So you have a proper grievance redressal, a mechanism of appeal, a mechanism of eventually approaching the courts. Here, if your grievance is against, for whatever reason, the design of the app, if there is a false positive or a false negative, am I really going to get much relief if I write to the makers of the app to say that, oh, you know, there was a problem with the design? So there is also conflict of interest problem when the regulator and the grievance redressal happens, you know, through the same body. We saw this in some way in the Aadhaar and the UIDAI, but I think some of those problems actually get magnified because right now there's no law.
Thanks for that, Vrinda. Gautam, there's a question for you, which talks about how, you know, drawing this distinction between smartphone users who are required to download the app and others who may not have a smartphone, do you think this in some way violates Article 14?
So my understanding is that they're bringing in an alteration that also then be used for landlines and non-smartphones. So that might be infructuous soon. In the meantime, I think like it's very obvious that it is, because what it effectively says is that if you are out on the street with a smartphone, the police can, you know, stop you and search you. And if they find your smartphone then it doesn't have Aarogya Setu, then you're in trouble. On the other hand, if you walk out of your home without a smartphone or don't have one, have a non-smartphone, and you're caught, then nothing will happen to you. I think this just shows you the illogicality underlying the Noida order, and it's a really bizarre distinction to draw in a country where actual smartphone penetration is so low.
There's also one more question, and I'll just read it out, which talks mainly about the least restrictive alternative prong of the proportionality standard and how courts understand it. So Raghav Bhargava asks, "Hi, my question is with regards to the least restrictive measure. While arguing any restriction and whether that amounts to a least restrictive measure, is there a burden on the petitioner to establish that a robust model of what would be least restrictive than the status quo? Let's say Arogya Setu aims to do A, B, and C. Would the petitioners be required to establish how it's not the least restrictive measure in case of A, B, and C and provide a model to counter it?" So do you think you or Vrinda could maybe offer a little bit of clarity for our audience members and viewers about what least restrictive especially means? Also, because I believe that there was some discussion in the Puttaswamy judgments about how effective the alternative needs to be, whether it should be equally effective or not. Gautam or Vrinda would like to take that.
I think Gautam will be able to do a lot of the Puttaswamy proportionality analysis better because he's sort of done many, many posts on that. Except to say, I wouldn't say that the Aadhaar judgment really spent a lot of time discussing the least restrictive measure. What they just seemed to do after setting out all the law was in one paragraph say, oh, you know, this is the most least restrictive measure, so the Aadhaar Act is fine. I think how you would have, there is definitely a burden on the petitioners to establish that there is the Arogya Setu, for instance, in the way it is currently designed, is not the least restrictive measure. So if you think about it in terms of collection, storage, and use, you would have to argue that the data that Arogya Setu is collecting, so for instance, location data, is not actually necessary. There are other countries, for instance, Singapore, which have done it only using GPS data. So what is the need to collect location data? So, you know, you have a question of collection limitation. When it comes to storage, you know, again, the least restrictive measure that the petitioners would have to show would be, do you need centralized storage or do you need localized storage? So should the data be stored only on the phones? Or what is the idea of, you know, sending all of this data to a server? So is there a way this could be done? When it comes to, again, the usage part of this sort of three-part test that I'm saying, you would have to establish a least restrictive measure. Can the data be restricted only, or should the data be restricted only to use for the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare? Should there be a specific clause that prevents any sharing of data for any reason whatsoever with, you know, any law enforcement agency? So is there a least restrictive measure? I don't think, and maybe Gautam would be able to elaborate and Surit would be able to elaborate in that the burden would extend so far as to actually propose a fully functioning alternative model. As long as you can say that there exists, you know, these ways that can be done, both, you know, theoretically and practically. And I think in Arogya Setu, in fact, this would be slightly easier than in other cases. Because unlike Aadhaar, which in its scale and gamut and planning, it's a very India-specific project. That's happening in many countries. So we actually have real-life examples of countries using a less restrictive measure to achieve similar or, you know, the same goals. So, you know, you could also point to examples of other countries doing it successfully, or in the alternative, just not even requiring a contact tracing, but finding other methods of solving the problem.
Yeah, just to add two brief points. One is that, again, the Aadhaar case is a good example of how this works, because what happened there was that you had Aadhaar made mandatory for four distinct things, welfare, bank accounts, mobile phones, and tax. For each of those things, the government had a stated purpose that they wanted to achieve, plugging leakages, preventing shell companies from holding bank accounts, plugging tax evasion, and preventing terrorism. These were the four justifications that gave for each of those, for making Aadhaar mandatory for each of these things. And if you look at the judgment, then the analysis was done on each limb. So is it proportionate to make Aadhaar mandatory for welfare? Supreme Court says yes. Is it proportionate to make it mandatory for bank account? Supreme Court says no. And each time it says, okay, like, is this the least restrictive alternative? Is it rational? Is it balanced? All of that. So yeah, I mean, so to answer the question, if the government has, like, say, three uses it proposes to put Arogya Setu to, tackling the pandemic and just, like, shooting in the dark here, like, say, in the future, health insurance, and something else. And for each of that, you have to examine it from the limb of proportionality for that particular use. And if the infringement upon rights is proportionate, given that that's the use that the government wants to put that forcibly collected data to. And the second thing, again, is to supplement the point is that, so it's not for the petitioners to like provide like a full infrastructure of how the alternative looks like, but to bring to the notice of the government and the court that there are these functional alternatives. And then it is for the government, because they have the best capacity to answer the question, to say that look, we considered these we found that nonetheless our choice is the least restrictive one that will fulfill the goal. And recently there was a Supreme Court judgment on cryptocurrency which discussed some of these points, and it actually found that those alternatives hadn't been even considered by the government. And even in the original Aadhaar case, actually, there was this discussion on how, with respect to bank accounts, the government hasn't even considered any alternative that could actually plug the problem of shell companies before it went down the Aadhaar route. So I think that like this issue of who has the burden of proving how much is a contested one, and it's more a question of common sense that, yeah, obviously, if you're challenging something, you should come in a case like this, if you're challenging like a infrastructure or like an institutional or design, you should have some alternative in mind. But once you've put that there, then you know it's for the government to say, okay, look, this won't work for XYZ reason.
Thanks for that, Gautam. We have a very...
I saw one of the comments. I made a mistake. I meant to say Bluetooth and not GPS. So that was that error of mine. I just saw some of the comments. So I meant to say that, Bluetooth data is obviously separate from location data, and I sort of used GPS and location as alternatives.
Clarification. Thanks for that clarification, Brinda. So we also have another interesting question by Tanisha in the chat box, where she talks about how something like Aarogya Setu could also become too big to fail as it, you know, as the function creep seeps in and as it's integrated with more and more services. And then she says that given our parliamentary culture where legislative processes take time and the judiciary sadly follows a similar trajectory, what are some immediate solutions? And I think this is a question that I think all three panelists will have thoughts on. So maybe we could start with, and then Brinda and Gautam could also chip in.
It's a very hard question to answer because, you know, one doesn't want to recommend disobedience in any way. We already had a challenge mounted to the Aarogya Setu application in the Kerala High Court. So I think the ball is in some senses with the courts. But we need to, I think, sort of ensure that we present this challenge at various different levels, right? We need to sort of, because ultimately the engines of change, I don't think, acting engines of liberty really are not merely these institutions, these democratic institutions, but it's the people. So you've got to reach it out to the people that these are the big problems with the application. Now, whether that's through different sort of modes of outreach programs, etc., it's for all of us to consider. But I don't think our challenge should be restricted merely to the realm of the judiciary in the sense of filing a petition saying that the app violates fundamental rights and is unconstitutional for XYZ reasons. That's one way of challenging. Now, I think IFF has already written to some of these parliamentary committees. I think today a representation was written, if I'm not mistaken, pointing out that the application lacks legal basis. So you want opposition parliamentarians, etc., to also take up the challenge. And that's one way of fighting it. And I think eventually, possibly, if the government stays by this and, you know, brings about, and I think at some point they'll bring out either an ordinance, and just like as was the case with Aadhaar, right? The moment the legal challenge was mounted, they realized that they had to bring about a legislation and in order to validate these actions that they'd already taken. So at some point, if this Aarogya Setu is going to be our future, I'm sure that Parliament will legislate. And at that point, we'll have to consider a properly considered challenge to it by way of a writ petition, and you know, either before one of the high courts or ultimately before the Supreme Court. And as we've discussed in response to some of the previous questions, whatever that challenge is going to be, it will have to be well mounted in the sense of bringing about alternatives to the table, showing through affidavits and through, you know, evidence that the application is not efficacious for XYZ reasons, that it lacks utility, that it's not the least restrictive measure available and that therefore it fails the constitutionality test. But it's, as I said, a very difficult question to answer, and it's a question that in many senses goes to our larger culture itself, in the sense of whether we have institutions that are strong enough to protect our rights. And we've seen this, I think, in a number of allied challenges, right? Whether we've had the challenges to the Citizenship Amendment Act. On the one hand, we've had a challenge made to the Supreme Court, and but we've seen that challenge languish because the court hasn't really taken it up for final arguments. But it's also sort of brought about a citizens' movement. So, and as I said, I think this battle for these digital rights are ultimately sort of almost going to be a defining moment in our democracy. And therefore, it might have to go beyond just the realm of the courts, and it has to be involve a larger sort of challenge, which is mounted in terms of democratic protest.
Gautam, Brinda, would you like to add to that?
No, it covers points for me, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have time for one more question before we have to wrap up. And I think one of the interesting questions that were asked earlier talked about how Arogya Setu may soon be required for accessing things like telemedicine, etc. Now, even if this is purely optional and voluntary, and you still have other ways to access, say, telemedicine, do you think the fact that this kind of data is being stored on an app which has a lot of security concerns is a problem even if there is consent? Or do you think that conversation stops the minute user gives consent?
Can I just briefly just respond to that specific point? I think again this issue of consent is framed in a binary that doesn't reflect what actually happens. And again, let's take the Aadhaar example, right? If basically you create these two tracks where if you have Aadhaar, life suddenly becomes very easy, and you can get your passport renewed in 48 hours, and you are able to access facilities in a much quicker and more efficient manner. And on the other hand, if you don't, then things just take longer, are harder, and are more difficult to accomplish. It's not really you're not being offered a choice between two equivalent alternatives. What you are being offered is a choice between giving up stuff on the one hand, complying with this imposition. So I think that you need to look at the issue of consent in a more nuanced way. And if effectively you're creating a system of incentives, very strong incentives to having the app and a very strong disincentives to not having it, then effectively you're still not leaving the citizen with any genuine choice. So I think that in constitutional law terms, we pretty much call it an unconstitutional condition. I mean, the condition for exercising your right to choose or your rights under Article 21 or 14 is the giving up of other rights, right? So, and that obviously can't be. So, yeah.
And to add to that, I mean, I think, this goes back to the question of why do we have the app in the first case? I think it is very easy to remember that, in times of normalcy, we protect our liberties, but in times of crisis, most people are very okay with giving up liberties, and that slowly becomes the norm. So Yuval Harari wrote this fantastic piece, right, where he talks about the normalization of, the sort of restrictions on our liberties. And if Arogya Setu is meant for this very specific, limited purpose, why is it that you're even building in any other apps into it? Why is it that you're making it this one stand, one place for all of these health services to come together? That was never the purpose of Arogya Setu. And I think all of this, stems from our sort of, this is what creates more fear and distrust with the government. If this is meant to be a limited app, make it limited. There is no need to access any other, put any other services on that and then say, oh, if you want, you can access it. But if you don't, it's your wish. So I think we really need to question why this app came into being. Like, what is it that we are effectively foregoing when we're asked to make, a choice between having the app and being okay with the app versus sort of having a two-track system where only those who are concerned about liberty or who are aware or are in the position to make the choice of you know, not giving certain information. So I think it's very important to really question this need to make the app a one-stop like health solution.
Thanks for that, Brinda. Well, that's all we have time for today. Thank you to everyone. Friday. Follow us on social media, especially on Instagram, because I am having similar events in the near future. That we will be signing off. Recording of the webinar will be available. So do media. Thank you, everyone. You all have a great Friday night.